Thank you. Our speaker today is Kate Charles, who is a crime writer with many successful books to her name. In fact, her latest book, False Tongues, is out now. I'm sure she's going to be talking about that too. Today, she's however going to talk to us mostly about another writer, Barbara Pym, from another generation. Both Kate and Barbara lived in Shropshire, and both use the Anglican Church as settings for their novel. So I wonder what else they have in common. Well, we'll soon find out. Ladies and gentlemen, Kate Charles.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me. I apologize in advance for my extremely low-tech presentation. I didn't realize that you were used to such a high standard of wizardry, but Barbara Pym, I lived in an age before such things as PowerPoint, and I thought it was in keeping to be very low-tech this morning. So the new curate seemed quite a nice young man. But what a pity it was that his combination showed, tucked carelessly into his socks when he sat down. Belinda had noticed it when they had met him for the first time at the vicarage last week and had felt quite embarrassed. Perhaps Harriet could say something to him about it. Her blunt, jolly manner could carry off these little awkwardnesses much better than Belinda's timidity. Of course, he might think it none of their business, as indeed it was not, but Belinda rather doubted whether he thought at all, if one were to judge by the quality of his first sermon. Harriet was making her usual fuss over the new curate and was obviously prepared to be quite as silly over him as she had been over his predecessors. She was especially given to cherishing young clergymen, and her frequent excursions to the curate's lodging had often given rise to talk, for people did like a bit of gossip, especially about a respectable spinster and church worker like Miss Harriet Bede. There was naturally nothing scandalous about these visits, as she always took with her a newly baked cake, some fresh eggs or fruit, for the poor young men always looked half-starved, or even a hand-knitted pullover or pair of socks, and then, of course, she would ask them to supper. The new curate coming to supper, a scene so fresh, so funny, so typically Barbara Pym. I was asked to come here today to talk to you about my favorite writer, Barbara Pym. It seemed to me that rather than try to tell you about her life and her work, I should share it with you. There is so much to share, such richness to enjoy, that I needed a focus. With my own interest in the Church of England, I decided to concentrate on Pym's fascination with the church, and more specifically on the clergy. In the end, I received my real inspiration and the title for this talk from a phrase which is used, in fact, in two of the novels, At Ease with Ladies. In No Fond Return of Love, Aylwin Forbes ponders, no doubt, like all men connected with the church, his brother Neville included, the organist would be at ease with ladies. He could see the phrase, at ease with ladies, as the title of a novel or even a biography. And in her last novel, A Few Green Leaves, she repeats the phrase and the sentiment. Emma had been thinking that no man would dare to attend the sale, but then she realized that, of course, there could be exceptions. A former Anglican priest might well have the sort of courage required for the occasion, and Adam, so very much at ease with ladies, obviously came into this category. And so I'm going to consider Barbara Pym's clergy in relation to the women in their lives, their wives, their sisters, and above all, those worthy parish women who support them and cherish them and pamper them and, heaven help them, even fall in love with them. Women of the sort describing excellent women as holy fowls, women like Harriet and Belinda Bede. by necessity, will be looking at male clergy only. Of course, there were no women clergy when Pym was writing, and I don't think she really envisioned a time when that might happen. And today I'll be concentrating on her Anglican clergymen. She did write about a few sinister Romans, and even a nonconformist or two, but it was the Church of England which she inhabited and loved, even as she described it in Crampton Hodnett, when her curate, Mr. Latimer, takes evensong. Yes, this was the Church of England, his flock, thought Mr. Latimer, a collection of old women, widows and spinsters, and one young man not quite right in the head. So it is with curates that we will appropriately begin. Curates in Barbara Pym novels are almost always described as good-looking. They are, in fact, much of a type, handsome, a bit pompous, taking themselves rather too seriously. There must be something about the type that appeals to Miss Harriet B. in Some Tame Gazelle, as her abiding interest and lifelong hobby is cherishing and feeding curates. There have been many of them over the years, apparently, all interchangeable and all equally doted upon, though the paler the better. Her sister Belinda is bemused by all of this. How many curates would starve and die were it not for the Harriets of this world, she thinks. And when they have reason to visit the curate's lodging. This was quite a nice room, not as meanly furnished as Harriet could have wished, though Belinda was relieved that they did not have to provide the curate with furniture as well as food. The current curate, and thus the object of Harriet's interest, is called Edgar Donne. His maternal grandfather was a bishop, which seems to give him an added luster. But he is as pompous and self-involved as any other Pym curate. His Christmas gift to the Bede sisters is a photograph of himself, which he gave to them rather shyly, obviously embarrassed by Harriet's cries of joy. Oh, how lovely and how good of you! Belinda, isn't it good of Mr. Donne? She thrust the photograph at Belinda, who was rather at a loss, as it looked so exactly like any of the other photographs of curates in Harriet's collection upstairs that she could hardly think what to say. Mr. Donne breaks the mold, though, when he does something that none of Harriet's curates has ever done before. He decides to get married. Or, rather, the decision is made for him when Olivia Berridge, the blue-stocking niece of the vicar's wife, Agatha, takes matters out of his hands and proposes to him. Predictably, this does not go down well with Harriet B. Perhaps clergymen feel that they ought not to ask people to marry them, said Belinda. The celibacy of the clergy, you know, she added vaguely. It's much better for a curate not to marry. Just imagine, a married curate, said Harriet in disgust. But it seems that Mr. Donne has done rather well for himself in Olivia. The parish gets its first glimpse of her at a party to celebrate their engagement. Edgar and I are simply delighted. There was comfort in the words, as if she were protecting Mr. Donne in a sensible tweed coat or even woolen underwear. It was obvious that she would take care of him, not letting him cast a clout too soon. She would probably help with his sermons, too, and embellish them with quotations rarer than her husband, with his third class in theology, could be expected to know. A helpmeet, indeed. We'll come back to Mr. Donne at the end. For now, though, we'll move on to Stephen Latimer, the new curate who arrives at the beginning of Crampton Hodnett. Mr. Latimer is auburn-haired, tall and broad-shouldered, charming and personable in a rather facile way, and it is arranged that he is to have a room in the North Oxford house of Miss Doggett, a formidable spinster, and her meek companion, Miss Jessie Morrow. From the outset, it is clear that Miss Doggett is no Harriet Bede. I can see to his material welfare, said Miss Doggett, and I believe he will find the atmosphere of my house an extremely cultured one. Miss Morrow thought of the dining room on a wet Sunday afternoon with the rain dripping off the dark branches of the monkey puzzle. And, continued Miss Doggett, I shall be able to keep an eye on him, insofar as that is necessary in one of his profession. It turns out to be rather more necessary than Miss Doggett thinks. At first he is circumspect and cautious. He believed that he was going to be very comfortable here. Of course Miss Doggett made a fuss of him, as all women did, but he rather liked this, as long as he wasn't expected to give anything in return, except the politeness and charm which came to him without effort. And after all, what else could he be expected to give to an old woman of 70? He liked the companion, too, an amusing, sensible little woman who wasn't likely to throw her arms round his neck, for poor Mr. Latimer had experienced even that. But very quickly, Mr. Latimer develops a friendship with Miss Morrow under Miss Doggett's very nose and without her being in the least aware of it. Mr. Latimer and Miss Morrow go for a walk on a Sunday afternoon, which results in his missing evensong, and this makes a bond between them that has interesting consequences. It was amazing how, even with the restraining presence of Miss Doggett, they always seemed to be talking about love, or what passed for love in a circle consisting of clergymen and spinsters. Thinking things over in bed that night, Mr. Latimer came to the conclusion that he might have to take some action in the matter himself, if only for his own safety and peace of mind. After all, he was 35 years old, old enough to know his own mind, and yet not so old that he would behave as those elderly clergymen one read about in the cheaper daily papers, who married a servant or a chorus girl of 18. He was a man of private means, good-looking and charming. It was obvious that he could never expect to have much peace until he was married. Besides, there was something comforting about the idea of having a wife, a helpmeet, somebody who would keep the others off and minister to his needs without being as fussy as Miss Doggett was. Some nice, sensible woman, not too young. And it was then that it occurred to him that he might do worse than marry Miss Morrow. He seizes the opportunity to carry through with this thought one evening when Miss Doggett is out. I think we always get on well together, began Mr. Latimer. Miss Morrow laughed. A curate and an old lady's companion, she said. But what else would you expect? Mr. Latimer wished that she hadn't put it like that, making themselves slightly ridiculous. It was a bad beginning, he felt, but he was not yet discouraged. I meant that in some ways we seem to be very close to each other, very near, he went on. Miss Morrow took her knitting out of its bag and began to count stitches. Oh, Miss Morrow, Janie, he burst out suddenly. My name isn't Janie. Well, it's something beginning with J, he said impatiently. It was annoying to be held up by such a triviality. What did it matter what her name was at this moment? Things go downhill from there, and Miss Morrow sensibly refuses him. By the end of the novel, Mr. Latimer has met someone else far more suitable while on holiday in Paris, the younger daughter of Lord Pimlico, no less, and has become engaged to her. Now we move on to A Glass of Blessings, where we encounter the beautiful Marius Ransom, the new curate of St. Luke's. Wilmot Forsythe, the first-person narrator of this book, describes him. His Christian name's Marius Lovejoy, and the first glimpse of him earlier in the evening had led me to expect somebody handsome, But even so, the impact of his good looks was quite startling. He was certainly very handsome indeed, with his dark wavy hair and large brown eyes. The bones in his face were well defined, and his expression serious. Predictably, Mr. Ransom is charming to the ladies of the parish, and is much admired, because there is no room at the clergy house, though it is necessary for him, like Mr. Latimer, to lodge with someone in the parish. In this case, it is old Mrs. Beamish, a dragon of a woman, and her dowdy spinster daughter, Mary. Not much of a danger for the beautiful Mr. Ransom there, you might think. Then old Mrs. Beamish dies, leaving Mr. Ransom a legacy of £500, and he moves out of the Beamish house and begins lodging with Father Edwin Sainsbury, a friend from theological college days. Father Sainsbury has leanings towards Rome, and the parishioners of St. Luke's are worried that Mr. Ransom might be swayed to follow him in leaving the Church of England. But Mr. Ransom surprises everyone by proposing to doughty Mary Beamish. Mary herself tells Wilmot about the proposal, how Marius, as she now calls him, arrived on the new motor scooter, which he's bought with her mother's legacy, and asked her to marry him. I could hardly confess my first reaction to her news, which was the perhaps typically feminine one of astonishment that such a good-looking man as Marius Ransom should want to marry anyone so dim and mousy as Mary Beamish. But as soon as I pushed aside this unworthy thought, I realized what a good wife she would make for a clergyman, especially one as unstable as Marius appeared to be. Mary was obviously just the person he needed to steady him, and the novelty and responsibility of marriage would surely take his mind off Rome. Before we move from curates onto vicars, I'd like to talk about a bishop. This may seem at the wrong point at which to do this, but as Belinda Bede observed, every bishop was a curate once, and Theodore Grote was, long ago, one of Harriet's beloved curates. Harriet had no difficulty in recalling him as one of the most sought-after curates in the history of the Church of England. In his heyday, there had been quite a procession of doting women towards his lodging, carrying cooked pheasants and chickens, iced cakes, even jellies in basins. He has now risen to be the Bishop of Mbawala in Africa. Dear Theo, he had certainly done splendid work among the natives, at least. That was what everyone said, although nobody seemed to know exactly what it was that he had done. Theo Grote's appearance in the village causes quite a stir, not least amongst the ladies of the parish. But Theo Grote has changed. Could a beautiful curate have grown into this tall, stringy-looking man with a yellow, leathery complexion? His expression reminded Belinda of a sheep more than anything. His face was long, his forehead domed, and his head bald. He was even rather toothy, a thing that Harriet abhorred. Could it be the same person, she wondered? But I certainly do remember you, he was saying. You knitted me a beautiful scarf when I was a curate. Belinda was decidedly taken aback. She had always thought it rather wonderful that she had never done anything of the kind. He must have been thinking of Harriet or another of his many admirers. The parishioners get their first glimpse of Bishop Grote at a gathering at the parish hall, where he lectures to them about his life in Africa. I dare say some of you would like to hear what the language sounds like, said the bishop. So I am going to sing a few verses of a song, which the Mbawala adapts to many occasions. Birth, marriage, death, all the great events in this mortal life have their own forms of it. He paused, as if wondering which was most suited to a gathering in a parish hall. Let me try and give you a marriage song, he said. Imagine yourselves taking part in an Umbawawa wedding. I do not feel myself equal to that, whispered Edith to Belinda. Death would have been a better choice, or even birth. The voice of the bishop rang out through the hall in song. Many handkerchiefs were taken out hastily, especially among the younger members of the audience, for the noise which filled the hall was quite unexpected. Even Belinda, who had heard the bishop sing as a curate, was a little unprepared. Belinda is equally unprepared for what happens next. Bishop Theo comes to call, and it is Belinda that he wants to see rather than Harriet. I think I had better speak more plainly, the bishop went on. I am asking you to marry me. There was a short but awkward silence, and then Belinda heard herself stammering out the first words that came into her head. Oh, but I couldn't. My dear, you are equal to being the wife of a bishop, he said kindly, making a movement towards her. You need have no fears on that account. When I was a younger man, I held views about the celibacy of the clergy. Young curates often do, you know. He smiled indulgently. It is a kind of protection, if you know what I mean. Belinda turns him down, but it isn't long until he finds someone more willing, one of the dim village spinsters whom he runs into in the Army and Navy store when he's stocking up on supplies before his return to Africa. The last we hear of him, Belinda is speculating about his future. Of course, he won't be the bishop of Mbawawa all his life. I suppose he may retire and write a book about his experiences. They often do, don't they? With cassock and surplice in Mbawawa land, retorted Edith. Yes, one knows the kind of thing only too well. If the typical Pym curate is good-looking and self-centered, the typical Pym vicar is a celibate Anglo-Catholic. As we've already seen with our curates, the celibacy of the clergy is a big issue with Barbara Pym. Her characters are constantly discussing the topic in relation to various clergy and as an abstract principle. Even those clergy who are married, like Mark Anger in An Unsuitable Attachment, sometimes wonder about it. His wife Sophia, a woman who seems more devoted to her cat Faustina than to her husband, tells him that Ianthe Broom is to marry. Surely that can't be a good thing. No, better not to marry, he agreed, but was thinking not of Ianthe and the young man from the library, but rather of the clergy in general, and perhaps at that moment of himself in particular. How could Faustina's hairs have got here, he had asked himself at the early mass that morning, seeing them on the fair linen cloth on the altar. And Nicholas Cleveland, husband of the eponymous Jane of Jane and Prudence, has second thoughts on the subject when Jane speaks out of turn at a PCC meeting and embarrasses him. She would never learn when not to speak, he thought, with rather less affectionate tolerance than usual. Not for the first time, he began to consider that there was, after all, something to be said for the celibacy of the clergy. But when the vicar in question is unmarried and good-looking, speculation reaches fever pitch, as in excellent women. Julian Mallory is the vicar of St. Mary's Pimlico, a man of about 40 who lives with his sister Winifred. Both of them have become friends with Mildred Laffrey, the narrator of the book. Mildred, whose father was a canon, is active in parish affairs. With my parochial experience, I know myself to be capable of dealing with most of the stock situations or even the great moments of life, birth, death, marriage, the successful jumble sale, the garden fate spoiled by bad weather. Mildred is such a help to her father, people used to say, after my mother died. So it is natural that she and Julian should become friends and that people should discuss his marital status with her. Helena Napier, Mildred's worldly neighbor, says, "He isn't married then? One of those?" I mean, she added apologetically, as if she had said something that might offend me, "One of the kind who doesn't marry?" "Well, he isn't married. As he's about 40, I dare say he won't now. I seem to have spent so much time lately in talking about the celibacy of the clergy in general, and Julian Mallory in particular, that I was a little tired of the subject." "That's just when they break out," laughed Mrs. Napier. "I always imagine that clergymen need wives to help them with their parish work, but I suppose most of his congregation are devout elderly women with nothing much to do, so that's all right. Holy fowl, you know." Mildred herself observes, "When Julian smiled, the bleakness of his face was softened and he became almost good-looking. There was something rather forbidding about his manner, so that women did not tend to fuss over him as they might otherwise have done. I am not even sure whether anyone had ever knitted him a scarf or pullover. I suppose he was neither so handsome nor so conceited as to pretend a belief in celibacy as a protection, and I did not really know his views on the matter. It seemed a comfortable arrangement for the brother and the sister to live together, and perhaps it is more suitable that a high church clergyman should remain unmarried, that there should be a Beretta in the hall rather than a perambulator." There are many in the parish who believe secretly that Julian and Mildred will marry. Julian depends a great deal on Mildred, but Mildred, along with the rest of the parish, is amazed when Julian becomes engaged to Allegra Gray, the attractive clergy widow who has moved into the refurbished flat at the top of the vicarage, after having been seen publicly holding hands with her. Mildred insists that people need not feel sorry for her. Marrying Julian was not what she wanted for herself. Allegra Gray invites her out to lunch for a heart-to-heart talk. "She was trying to tell me how glad and relieved she was that I didn't mind too much when I must surely have wanted to marry Julian myself. 'Oh, no, of course I don't mind,' I said. 'We have always been good friends, but there's never been any question of anything else, nothing more than friendship.' Julian thought perhaps," she hesitated. "He thought that I loved him?" I exclaimed in rather too loud a voice, I'm afraid, for I noticed a woman at a nearby table making an amused comment to her companion. "But what made him think that?" "Although I suppose there would have been nothing extraordinary in it if you had," said Mrs. Gray, slightly on the defensive. "You mean it would be quite the usual thing? Yes, I suppose it might very well have been. How stupid of that I had not been to see it like that, for it had not occurred to me that anyone might think I was in love with Julian. But there it was, the old obvious solution. Presentable unmarried clergyman and woman interested in good works. Had everyone seen it like that? And then it all ends in tears. As Julian discovers the true duplicitous nature of Allegra Gray and arrives on Mildred's doorstep shortly after a tearful Winifred. I went down and found Julian Mallory outside the door. He was hatless and had flung round his shoulders one of those black speckled mackintoshes which seem to be worn only by clergymen. He looked worried and upset. I could not think why he should be carrying a couple of ping-pong bats in his hand until I remembered that it was his boys' club night. "The engagement is broken off," said Julian flatly, laying down the ping-pong bats rather carefully on the kitchen table. Julian did not tell us very much about what had happened. It appeared that he had come in and asked where Winifred was, and then the whole story had come out. I should never know exactly what had passed between him and Allegra Gray. There are some things too dreadful to be revealed, and it is even more dreadful how, in spite of our better instincts, we long to know about them. I found myself worrying about irrelevant details. Who had actually done the breaking off? Had she given him back the ring? And how did it come about that he was still carrying the ping pong bats, which he had presumably taken from the boys' club to the vicarage when he came to my flat? Had he perhaps been holding them in his hand all the time the dreadful scene was going on? I knew that things like that could happen. Mildred goes on, it is much better to have found out now rather than later. Yes, that is what people say, isn't it? I suppose one must bear the humiliation of having made a mistake. I obviously had no idea of her true character. You see, I thought her such a fine person. She was certainly very pretty, I thought, but did not say it. I could not add to the burden of his humiliation by pointing out that he may have been taken in, like so many men before him, by a pretty face. Of course, it was mostly my fault, Julian went on. I can see that now. Well, I imagine there are always faults on both sides, though one person may be more to blame than the other, but I'm sure you need not reproach yourself for anything you did. Thank you, Mildred, he said with a faint smile. You are very kind. I don't know what we'd do without you. Perhaps clergymen shouldn't marry, I said, realizing that Julian was a free man again and that we ladies of the parish need no longer think of ourselves as the rejected ones. But the thought did not at that moment arouse any very great enthusiasm in me. Some seem to manage it very successfully, said Julian rather sadly. I could think of nothing to say beyond suggesting that he could always have another try, but this did not seem to be quite the moment to say it. I know the kind of person I should like to marry, he went on, and I thought I had found her, but perhaps I looked too far, and there might have been somebody nearer at hand. I stared into the electric fire and wished it had been a coal one, though the functional glowing bar was probably more suitable for this kind of an occasion. I cannot see what flowers are at my feet, said Julian softly. Nor what soft incense hangs upon the boughs, I continued to myself, feeling that the quotation had gone wrong somewhere, and that it was not really quite what Julian had intended. That's Keats, isn't it? I asked rather bluntly. I always think Nor What Soft Incense would be a splendid title for a novel, perhaps about a village where there were two rival churches, one high and one low. I wonder if it's ever been used. Julian laughed, and the slight embarrassment which I had felt between us was dispelled. He put on his speckled mackintosh, but seemed to forget about the ping pong bats on the kitchen table, nor did I like to remind him. And then we have Neville Forbes, the vicar in No Fond Return of Love. The book opens with his brother Aylwin, an academic, preparing to present a paper on Some Problems of an Editor. But I suspect that Barbara Pym is more interested in Some Problems of a Celibate Priest. Neville's problems have to do with women, and it is no wonder. Father Forbes is handsome enough to be a curate. He is described as exceptionally good-looking, similar in features to his brother Aylwin, but less careworn, the hair fairer and curling round the temples like an angel in an Italian Renaissance painting. Dulcie Mannering visits Neville's church and witnesses a scene, a woman rushing into the church in tears. She talks to Neville's housekeeper. He's not married? Asks Dulcie boldly. Oh, no. The woman looks surprised at the question, as if Dulcie ought to have known that he was not married. But of course, a good-looking man like that would have his difficult moments, only to be expected, seeing what women are, too. People are only human after all, be they male or female, she added rather strangely. Dulcie could not but agree. What does it mean, being only human after all, she asked herself. It was generally said of a person who had committed some indiscretion or even sin. It looked rather as if Neville Forbes had got himself involved with some woman, perhaps a young Sunday school teacher, or even a married woman. Later, Dulcie tells her friend Viola about how this happened. I don't suppose it was anything much, said Viola in her usual damping way. The clergy are always having women make scenes over them. One reads about it in the papers nearly every day. Clergymen are rather at the mercy of women, aren't they? Always popping into church at odd times. And people are only human after all, be they male or female. That's what the housekeeper said. The woman in question, it turns out, is a Miss Spicer. Dulcie and Violet return to the church and hear more details from the indiscreet housekeeper. That's right, dear, she said. She fell in love with Father Forbes. Well, she's the first to do that. He is good looking, you know, although I say it, she giggled, as if being his housekeeper made it somehow immodest and unsuitable for her to praise him. But he's a celibate, of course. Here her tone took on a sterner, more vigorous tone. And anyone can see that. It sticks out a mile. Dulcie asks what happened. Oh, she said she loved him, waylaid him one night after benediction. A week or two ago now, must have been before Lent. Quinquagesima, I believe. Anyway, she followed him back to the vicarage. I remember I hurried on ahead because I had a cauliflower cheese in the oven and I was just going to make some toast when I heard her voice in the hall, or rather his voice. What was he saying? Viola asked. Oh, I didn't hear really, said the housekeeper. I suppose the kind of things men do say when women get troublesome in that way. Are there, then, things that men invariably say in such situations? Dulcie wondered. Does it happen all that often? Perhaps more to the clergy than to other men, and perhaps they, being practiced speakers anyway, would find the things easier to bring out. In confusion, Neville flees from his London parish and goes to stay with his mother, an eccentric woman who runs a guest house in a North Devon resort town. But his mother is less than thrilled to be landed with Neville and his problems. Neville could hardly even be called upon to wait at table, for he insisted on wearing his cassock all the time. And even had he worn only an ordinary dark suit in his clerical collar, he would still have looked a little unusual, taking the dishes from the hatch and bringing them to the table. Besides, people just did not like a clergyman wandering about in a hotel. It was to be hoped that he would have gone back before the Easter visitors arrived. Although he had said nothing about his reasons for coming, Mrs. Forbes guessed that it must be, in her own words, trouble with a woman. For it had happened before. What began as a pleasant friendship between a priest and parish worker all too often blossomed, or should one say degenerated, into love on the woman's part. And even now Neville seemed quite unable to deal with it. He should either marry or go into a monastery, thought Mrs. Forbes firmly, though even marriage would not prevent the female members of his flock from falling in love with him. Still, a strong-minded woman could be a powerful deterrent to all but the most determined. And then Neville makes a surprise decision and tells his mother. It may be that I shall have to marry her, he said, almost to himself. I mean that it might make things easier all round, and I dare say she'd make quite a good wife, he said doubtfully. I thought you didn't hold with marriage. I don't really for a priest, but there could be situations where one might have to sacrifice one's principles for the happiness of another person. Another handsome celibate clergyman who toys with the idea of marriage is Father David Liddell in Quartet in Autumn. When Letty, one of the eponymous quartet, goes to visit her friend Marjorie in the country, she finds that Marjorie is well acquainted with and interested in the new vicar. The Reverend David Liddell, he liked to be called Father, was a tall, dark man in his middle 40s who certainly looked good in his vestments. Nice for Marjorie to have an interesting new vicar, Letty thought, generously indulgent. Then later, seen at closer quarters and in civilian clothes, Father Lydell was disappointing. He looked sadly ordinary in a ginger-colored tweed jacket and gray flannel trousers with something not quite right about the cut of them, too wide or too narrow, or at least not what one saw people wearing now. Father Lydell, obviously with no evening meal of his own in view, lingered on, so that Marjorie had to ask him to stay to supper. "One is at a slight disadvantage," he said elliptically, when Marjorie left the room to prepare the meal, and he and Letty were left alone. "Oh, in what way?" Letty was not sure whether he meant the disadvantage to apply to himself or to the human race in general. "In being able to return hospitality," he explained, "Marjorie has been so kind." So he called her by her Christian name, and there had been other meals. Later yet, Letty was not altogether surprised to get the letter from Marjorie saying that she was going to marry David Lydell. "David and I found that we were just two lonely people with so much to give each other," Marjorie wrote. Letty did not bother to read the last part of the letter very carefully. Skimming over the final page, Letty learned that David was such a fine person, he had been lonely and misunderstood in his last parish, and some people hadn't been too kind. Finally, they were so much in love that the difference in their ages, I am of course 10 years older than he is, didn't make the slightest difference. Letty reflected that the difference must be nearer 20 years than 10, but was prepared to accept the fact of their love, even if she couldn't understand it. But it would seem that Marjorie is not the only woman in the parish interested in David Lydell. "This is one of Father Lydell's favorite dishes," said Beth, bringing a covered casserole to the table. "Poulet niçoise, I hope you like it." "Oh yes," Letty murmured, remembering the time she had eaten poulet niçoise at Marjorie's house. Had David Lydell gone all around the village, sampling the cooking of the unattached women before deciding which one to settle with? Afterwards, Marjorie said, "It was rather funny about the poulet niçoise and the way Beth had to let us know that she had asked David into meals. She made a dead set at him, you know." And then disaster strikes. Marjorie rings to tell Letty that the engagement had been broken off. "Beth Doughty," Marjorie wailed, "and I had no idea." For a moment, Letty couldn't remember who Beth Doughty was. Then it came back to her. The efficient woman who knew the kind of food David Lydell liked and remembered his passion for Orvieto. There was something shocking in the idea of two women competing for the love of a clergyman with the lure of food and wine. But the whole pattern slotted into place. Letty began to wonder whether Beth Doughty might not also be rejected in her turn, whether no woman would succeed in bringing David Lydell to the point of marriage, but she did not say anything of this. Atypically, Father Oswald Thames, in A Glass of Blessings, is not a handsome clergyman in his middle years, in spite of the fact that he has exquisite taste. And, like David Lydell, holidays in Italy, he proves himself, every time he opens his mouth, to be a bit of an old windbag. He is described as a tall, scraggy old man with thick white hair and a beaky nose, not exactly the sort of thing to set feminine hearts aflutter. But that does not mean that he is above using what leverage he has on the women in his congregation. He writes in the parish magazine of his difficulties at the clergy house now that his housekeeper is retiring. "Now we are really in the soup. Prayers, please, and practical help. Isn't there some good woman who would feel drawn to do really Christian work and look after Father Bode and myself? We can just about boil an egg between us." Wilmot Forsythe reads his plea as she sits in the church, and he appears before her. "Good afternoon, Mrs. Father Thames, in a splendid cloak, clasped at the neck with gilt lion's heads, hovered over me like a great bird. "Do you know," he went on, "I thought for one moment when I saw you sitting there reading the parish paper that you might be the answer to prayer. I flushed for a moment and preened myself, almost as if I had been paid some frivolous compliment at a party. I've just been reading about Mrs. Greenhill leaving," I said. "I do hope you've got somebody else to keep house for you." "No, alas, not yet. That was why I was thinking how wonderful it would be if you, reading my cri de coeur," he paused and gave me a most appealing look. "I wondered whether many men, perhaps the clergy especially, went about cajoling or bullying women into being the answer to prayer. I suppose that the technique must often be successful. Successful enough for Tom Dagnall to repeat it. Tom, the middle-aged rector in A Few Green Leaves, is described as a tall man, austerely good-looking, but his brown eyes lacked the dog-like qualities so often associated with that color. He has been left in the lurch by his sister Daphne, who has decamped to greener pastures, Birmingham, to live with her bossy friend Heather. He writes in the parish magazine, "It is often said that the best chefs are men, but I cannot claim to belong to that noble and skilled fraternity. So I am going to throw myself on the mercy of the ladies and put my trust in their kind hearts and culinary skills. I am asking you to take pity on me and invite me to an occasional meal in your homes, to share in whatever you are having yourselves, a simple family meal eaten in congenial company." One of the women, perhaps the only one to fall for this line, is Emma Halleck, a newcomer to the village. Emma isn't really a churchgoer, but she likes Tom and feels a bit sorry for him, and he is more than willing to take advantage of her from the very first. It occurred to him that even if she didn't come to evensong, she might be helpful in other ways. She might be a good typist, though he could hardly ask her to do such menial work, or even be an expert at deciphering Elizabethan handwriting, a skill none of his willing lady helpers possessed. Note the plural here. Tom, it would seem, is a user of women. His passion in life is local history, and he seems obsessed by such trivia as the location of a deserted medieval village and the ancient custom of burying in wool. The ladies of the parish help him by copying inscriptions from old tombstones and poring through old parish records, and on the domestic side he is looked after by his sister Daphne. Tom was once married, but his wife died. At one point he talks to Emma about his late wife. Tom went on talking about the time after Laura had died and even seemed to be making excuses for not having married again. "I didn't seem to have the chance or meet anyone suitable." He must have been aware how feeble he sounded, as if a man, especially one connected with the church, couldn't meet a woman if he had a mind to, however much hemmed in by a sister. "But people in your parish, in London and here, there must have been," Emma protested. "Oh, there were, of course. Every church has plenty of eligible women, but somehow..." Tom, by Emma's own observation, could not be called dynamic. And though he is personable and good-looking, people like Emma's mother can't help thinking of him as poor Tom. Ineffectual was the word that sprang to mind when she thought of Tom. Not even capable of locating the site of that ridiculous deserted medieval village in the woods, and not all that efficient in the running of the church either. Beatrix found herself remembering certain lapses of detail, Christmas decorations still up on the first Sunday after Epiphany, daffodils on the altar at Quinquagesima, surely incorrect, which Tom ought to have picked up on but probably hadn't even noticed. But of course, he had lost his wife, one must remember that, and was saddled with the unfortunate Daphne. Poor Tom, And poor Daphne. Definitely poor Daphne. Daphne herself wonders about this. All these years making a home for somebody who hardly even noticed that she was there. Heather always said it had been a mistake, this rushing to make a home for Tom when Laura died. If it hadn't been for her doing this, Tom might have married again. Probably would have done, seeing the way women went after the clergy. Had she protected him from a grisly fate or stood in the way of his happiness? She would never know. The reader will never know either, though there is some suggestion at the very end of this, her last novel, that Emma and Tom will get together. I'm not sure whether this is a good thing or a bad thing, at least for Emma. For poor Tom, surely it would be a great relief after Daphne's defection. That leads us neatly into the category of married clergymen. There are a few in Pym, mostly on the sidelines. Even in books in which they feature as important characters, they take second place to their more interesting wives. There is, for example, Nicholas Cleveland, husband of Jane in Jane and Prudence. Jane is a wonderful character, scatty, disorganized, and imaginative. Nicholas, in contrast, is a mild-mannered fellow, low to middle in churchmanship, vague and kindly, somewhat otherworldly, unambitious, given to childish delight in animal-shaped soaps. He has the rather far-fetched idea of growing his own tobacco as an economy measure and ends up drying the leaves from the clothes error in the vicarage kitchen. And then there's Mark Anger in An Unsuitable Attachment. Mark is married to Sophia, and the word that best describes him is remote. There is a mention of Mark's eyes, which were also blue, but with that remote expression sometimes found in the eyes of sailors or explorers. Although invariably kind and courteous, he had the air of seeming not to be particularly interested in human beings, a somewhat doubtful quality in a parish priest, though it had its advantages. Even odder and more remote is Archdeacon Henry Hockley, the vicar of the parish in Somtaine Gazelle. Henry is difficult, irascible, learned, quirky, unpersonable, not at all accommodating or kindly. He is also larger than life, much given to wandering about the churchyard among the tombs, declaiming melancholic 18th century poetry. Henry is married to Agatha, a formidable woman whose father was a bishop. But the main woman in his life is none other than Belinda Bede, who has cherished an unrequited love for him for over 30 years, since their days together at university. Occasionally, she allows herself to think wistfully of how things might have been, as in when looking at wool in the wool shop. And here was an admirable clerical gray, such a nice soft wool, too. Would she ever dare to knit a pullover for the archdeacon? She might send it anonymously, or give it to him casually, as if it had been left over from some Christmas charity parcel. Surely that would be quite seemly, unless, of course, it might appear rather ill-mannered. Belinda decides to buy the wool. After all, she might make a jumper for herself, now that she came to think of it, and she was certain she would, either that or something else equally safe or dull. When we grow older, we lack the fine courage of youth, and even an ordinary task, like making a pullover for somebody we love or used to love, seems too dangerous to be undertaken. Oh dear, things get more interesting later in the book, when Agatha goes off to a German spa to take the waters, and Belinda finds the courage to pamper Henry a bit. But we know as well as she does that nothing will ever come of it. I could go on for hours, but I promise you that I'm almost finished. I'd like to return for just a moment to the title of my talk, At Ease with Ladies, and the implications of that title. My conclusion is that Barbara Pym, in her novels, treated the clergy as a sort of third gender, not women, but not exactly real men either. References abound, and I'll give you just a few. Take, for example, Julian Mallory, when he experiences difficulty with distempering. I suppose I am not to be considered as a normal man, said Julian, taking off his yellow-streaked cassock and draping it over the stepladder, and yet I do have these manly feelings. And later, when Mildred and her friend Dora see Julian holding hands with Allegra Gray, it looks odd to see a clergyman holding somebody's hand in public, said Dora chattily. I don't know why, but it does. After all, a clergyman is a man and entitled to human feelings, Dora went on. It was obvious to me now that she was in the kind of mood to disagree automatically with everything I said, for usually she maintained that clergymen didn't count as men and therefore couldn't be expected to have human feelings. And similarly, in A Few Green Leaves, Tom, being the rector of the parish, hardly seemed in Emma's eyes to count as an eligible man. In Jane and Prudence, Nicholas is drying out his tobacco leaves all over the vicarage kitchen when Miss Doggett calls. To make matters worse, the vicar now emerged from behind a screen of leaves, his usual mild expression betraying that there was nothing at all extraordinary about the situation. He, too, was wearing a flowered apron, which somehow took away from the dignity of his clerical collar, Miss Doggett felt. Well, there is no objection to the vicar hearing what I have to say, said Miss Doggett. I feel I can almost count as another woman, said Nicholas, perhaps rather too lightly. Nicholas emasculated both visually and verbally. One of the characters in No Fond Return of Love did not care for men with their roughness and lack of daintiness, though the clergy were accepted unless they smoked pipes. An iambic broom, whose father was a canon, did not like men very much, except for the clergy. In this matter, I think I'll let Miss Doggett have the last word. A man can have his thoughts, suggested Miss Morrow. Perhaps they do not care to be left alone with those, said Jane. I often wonder when I leave Nicholas alone in his study. But surely, Mrs. Cleveland, a clergyman must be different. He would be thinking out a sermon or a letter to the bishop. And now I really am finished, but I shall come full circle and leave you where we began with some tame gazelle. At the wedding of Harriet's beloved curate, there was cause for new hope. The third from the left, whispered Harriet eagerly. Belinda looked about her, rather puzzled. Then she saw what her sister meant, for in a corner she saw five curates, all young and pale and thin, with the exception of one who was tall and muscular and a former rugby blue, as she afterwards learned. The third from the left. How convenient of the curates to arrange themselves so that Belinda could so easily pick out Harriet's choice. He was dark and rather Italian-looking, paler and more hollow-cheeked than the others. It was true that the curate on whom Harriet had lavished so much care and attention was now a married man and lost to them, but another had come in his place, so like that they would hardly realize the difference, except that he was rather Italian-looking and had had a nervous breakdown. I think I'll ask him after the reception, although it's rather soon. But we do want to make him welcome at once, don't we? Harriet was speaking eagerly to her sister. Belinda smiled. Of course, dear. Asking the new curate to supper seemed a particularly happy thought. I knew you would agree, said Harriet, making boldly for the curate's corner. Belinda was looking round the room to see if she could find some sympathetic person to whom she could say that Dr. Johnson had been so right when he had said that all change is of itself an evil, when she saw Harriet approaching with the new curate. She smiled and shook hands with him, but before either of them could utter a suitable platitude, Harriet had burst in with the news that the young man was coming to supper with them on his first Sunday evening in the village, which would be in about a fortnight's time. He says he is fond of boiled chicken, she added. Now everything would be as it had been before.
Thank you so much. Have you got-
got a little bit manipulative.
Certainly, yes, yes. Yes, and I feel at a disadvantage because I know you're all out there, but I haven't been able to see anything. She started writing in the, first of all, she was born in Oswestry, so she's quite a local girl. She was born in 1913, and she started writing quite young when she had just finished university. She was much prone to falling in love with people, and she fell in love with a chap at university. And when she had finished university, which was in the mid-30s, she started writing. She went back to Oswestry and started writing. And she wrote Some Tame Gazelle, and which she cast herself, her sister, and her friends at university as these characters who were now middle-aged and living in an Oxfordshire village. So she is Belinda. Her sister is Harriet. And Henry, the archdeacon, is this chap that she was in love with, Henry Harvey. She wrote for some years, and of course her writing was interrupted by the war, and she was in the Varennes during the war. But she started in earnest after the war in writing novels, and her first novels were published in the early 1950s. She wrote seven novels that were published running in the decade of the 50s, and in around 1960, the novel that she wrote and submitted to her publisher was unexpectedly turned down, and he explained that times had changed. We're now in the swinging 60s, the 50s are over, and people want things that are more up to date. They're not interested any longer in spinsters and vicars and curates. They want to read about young people in coffee shops and Carnaby Street and cool London and that sort of thing. So she spent 13 years unpublished. She continued to write during that time, but she had sending her books out to people, but her books kept coming back, rejected, 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 going in the bottom drawer. It was terribly, terribly demoralizing for her as a writer. But she befriended, during this period of time, she was befriended by Philip Larkin, the poet, who carried on a very lengthy correspondence with him over the years. And he was a great champion of her works. And he read some of her unpublished things and thought very highly of them. So in 1963, I believe it was, 1973, after 13 years unpublished, the Times Literary Supplement had a feature where they asked various distinguished people who was the most underrated, undervalued writers of the century, and Philip Larkin and Lord David Cecil both named Barbara Pym. She was the only person who was named twice. And overnight, the publishers were all at her door. Fortunately, she had a bottom drawer full of manuscripts, which she was able to get very quickly. The first one that she had published was The Quartet in Autumn, and it was shortlisted for the Booker. So she very quickly went from forgotten obscurity to the Booker Prize dinner. But unfortunately, she also, I think probably due to all the stress in her life, she had contracted cancer, and she was fighting breast cancer for several years, and she died at a fairly young age of breast cancer in around 1979. So, all in all, she wrote the first books that she wrote in the 50s are called the canon, which are really the ones that that best represent her as a developing writer. The ones that she wrote afterwards that were in the bottom drawer, some are better than others. They're quite different. Portrait in Autumn is a very, some find it a depressing book rather than a funny book. It's certainly an elegiac book. It's informed by her own worsening health. And The Sweet Dove Died is a incredibly sad book. And some of the ones that were published after she died, Crampton Hodnett was not published until after her death. It was a very early one that she wrote shortly after she left university. And while it is a wildly funny book and I love it, it had not really been deemed suitable for publication while she was alive. And one of her posthumous books, An Academic Question, she was trying to be Margaret Drabble, really, and it wasn't successful at all. And I don't think it's a very good book at all. So the long answer to your question is, all in all, there are about, depending on whether you count the collection of short pieces that was published later, there are about 12 to 13 books. No, my latest book is called False Tongues. It is the fourth in a series of books about a woman curate in a parish in London. Surprisingly enough, yes. And I am very, very fortunate that SPCK, who are the third oldest publisher in the country after Oxford and Cambridge University Presses. They were founded in 1698. And up until last year, they had never published a work of fiction. They are very well known for books of theology and church history and all sorts of things related to the Christian faith in a very factual way. And they decided last year to start publishing fiction. And so I've been the fortunate recipient of that decision, and they've done False Tongues, and they're also reissuing my first series of five books, including these two that are out now, and the other three will be up next month. So I'm very, very pleased. I have, if anyone's interested in my books, I do have a website, katecharles.com. I also have with me some cards with the titles of my books as a little aid memoir, if anyone would be interested in having them. I've also left a few of the Barbara Pym Society newsletters, which is called Green Leaves, out there, and anyone who is interested in the Barbara Pym Society is very welcome to take one of them.
Thank you. Sounds like you're Barbara Pym.
Well, the review in The Guardian said a bloodstained version of the word of Barbara Pym.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.